sit back, relax, and I hope you enjoy. Much love to all.
Missing in this analysis is any ambivalence regarding slavery. Although Herodotus mentions slaves repeatedly, he always does so in an offhand, matter-of-fact manner. As merely a system within the common hierarchies of antiquity in Greece, throughout the Greek Empire, and among barbarians across the known world. At least as early as the 7th century BCE, nomadic, loosely organized societies around the Black Sea region established an efficient trade network furnishing slaves to the wealthy of Greek society. Regions long fabled in myth, such as Thrace, now southern Bulgaria, northeastern Greece, and northwestern Turkey, homeland of the Roman slave Spartacus, and Colchis, now Georgia, in particular, seem to have supplied the bulk of them. Impoverished parents and kidnapping pirates delivered slaves to the market, and famine and warfare regularly increased the supply of people offered up for sale. Could oligarchic Greece have thrived without slavery? Could the philosophers and citizens attending to their businesses and that of the state ever have arisen without such a lower class doing the work? Plato owned 50 slaves. And households with 10 or more bondspeople were common. Going about town or on long military campaigns, Athenian gentlemen always took along a slave or two. Quite likely, slaves outnumbered free people in the 5th and 4th centuries BCE, probably numbering 80,000 to 100,000 in Athens alone. Multitudes of enslaved women worked primarily at household tasks, providing services that could be sexual, medical, and domestic, while male slaves, skilled and unskilled, labored in the fields, on board ships, and in industrial workshops. Athens used an enslaved Scythian police force numbering between 300 and 1,000, for Scythians were known as skilled archers. The slave trade worked like this, as noted. The Black Sea line of supply began with barbarian chiefs whose endless warfare steadily drove refugees onto the market, where chiefs sold them to Greek slave traders for luxury goods like wine and clothing. Not that war was a prerequisite, thousands of children also entered the market, having been sold by their parents for salt or other necessities. Two cities, Byzantium, later Constantinople and then modern Istanbul, and Ephesus, Asia Minor's most important Greek city, dominated the market in slaves. Ephesus is probably best known today as the home of the Ephesians of the Bible, whose Christian church was one of seven in Asia to which Saint Paul addressed his letters. No shame attended this brutal business. A Greek Macedonian proudly listed his occupation as slave trader on his funeral stele and had engraved on it the image of 8 slaves chained together by their necks. To be sure, some practices did offend Greek morals. Herodotus mentions a slave trader who was punished for castrating freeborn boys and selling them as eunuchs. But even so, ancient Greeks are rightly known for their appreciation of good-looking boys, and when ancient sources speak of the beauty of slaves, they mean boys, not women and girls. A ruling class quite easily judges the lower orders to be innately servile. More than a century before Aristotle discoursed on the naturalness of slavery and the inherently slavish nature of the enslaved in politics and Nicomachean ethics, Herodotus scolds the Thracians for so readily selling their children for export. Not that matters of slavery were always so simple. Herodot relates an anecdote demonstrating the two sides of slave life, a chance for upward mobility and a circumscribed possibility for success. In roughly 5:1-2 C.E. The Scythian army undertook a war against the Persian king Darius that continued for 28 years. And the Scythians won. But 28 years of absence had wrought changes at home.
Thank you for watching. I hope to see you again soon. Till the next time, much love.